Happy birthday to Jesus.
It does look good out there, Cynthia. Yeah. Y'all so pretty. Glad to see everybody here today. And it is Christmas time in the city. We talked about that last week also. But it is Christmas time, no matter if you're in the city or not, right? It's Christmas time, whether you're ready for it or not. So last week we kind of jumped in Matthew chapter 2. We're going to be back there today, kind of looking at some different characters that are there in Matthew chapter 2. Last week we talked about King Herod the Great, the Scrooge, right? So, and we said, well, how do we know? Like, how do you know? What really signals you that it's Christmas time? I mean, I know it's different things for different people, but how do we know that it's Christmas? And we sort of mentioned a few things last week. It's Christmas time when we see lots of shoppers. It's Christmas time when we see lots of traffic. I guess the best way for most of us, especially people like me, is the calendar, right? I mean, the calendar kind of like tells us when it is, because Christmas is the same time every year, right? December the 20th. Is that right? December 20th, right? Y'all just go along with me, right? You don't argue with me at all. So Christmas is the same time every year. December 25th, it rolls around, whether we're ready for it or not. But how did they know, how on the first Christmas did they know that it was Christmas time? Well, in Matthew chapter 2, we find some things there that kind of tell us how they knew. Matthew chapter 2, verse 1. Now, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he who was born king of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose, and have come to worship him." Then Herod the king, when Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all of Jerusalem with him. And assembling all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Christ child was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for it was written by the prophet." So here's kind of our hinge point. Now, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men came from the east, came to Jerusalem. Wise men from the east came to Jerusalem. So wise men is how they knew. That's how Herod and the city knew. That's how in the city they knew that it was Christmas time, because wise men, scholars, astrologers, whatever you want to call them, most likely, you know, when we do the, a lot of times over the years, and I guess still, when we do Christmas plays, we'd call them kings, you know, we three kings from the Orient. They most likely were not kings. They may have been somebody who would maybe been advisors or representatives for a king or kings. But for them, they knew by a star that they came looking for that Jesus had been born. And that alerted Herod. Herod the Great, you know, we talked about him quite a bit last week, that it was Christmas time. And Matthew chapter 2, verse 3 says that when Herod heard, he was full of fear and trouble. And we talked about, and I want to talk about again today, what does it mean? How do we know when it's Christmas? And what does it mean when Christmas comes? Well, for Herod, it was a time of terror. It was a time of trouble. It was a time that he was upset because he felt like there was going to be somebody else that was going to take his position as king. So this week, I want to look at some other characters. You know, as we said, well, Herod was the original Grinch. And he would totally have stolen Christmas forever if he could have. But it didn't work for him, did it? Because we're still celebrating the birth of Jesus all these years later. Herod did not squish our celebration. He did not stop the birth and the life of Jesus. He did not stop what it was that Jesus was born to do. like the song that Jim sang a few minutes ago, he was a baby born to die. He was a baby born to die for us. So, in verse 3, and if you've got your Bible app or your Bible or however you're following along, verse 3 says, when Herod the king heard this, he was troubled in all of Jerusalem with him. And assembling all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. Okay, so verses 3 and 4 there, I want to kind of look at this story from the standpoint of the chief priest and scribes for just a few minutes. I said last week, I don't remember ever hearing anybody talk about King Herod the Great as far as the Christmas story goes. You know, normally we want to look at the real characters like Jesus and Mary and Joseph and some of those. I feel like they are the main characters, but what did it mean to some of the others? You know, what does it mean to us is really what we want to bring it down to. Can we identify with King Herod? Are we troubled sometimes when it's Christmas time? We talked about some scenarios last week. Maybe the family's over, maybe the in-laws. You know, I don't want to get too deep into family situations, but you know, it could be that that Christmas is a troubled time. Maybe it's because of some traumatic thing that's happened in your world that year, or maybe, you know, a lot of times the holidays bring out stressful situations in people's lives. And so maybe we can kind of identify with Herod. And so maybe by the end of the service today, and we're going to be talking about this probably again next week with a different character, but the chief priests and scribes, when it came to Christmas, the chief priests and scribes had all the answers. Do you know anybody like that? Yeah, all the answers. I mean, last week, we kind of talked about every family has aunt so-and-so, uncle so-and-so, whatever. And if you don't know who that is, then it's probably you. So, hopefully not, but, you know, it could be. Well, the chief priests and scribes, they were very knowledgeable people. They had all the answers. When it came to Christmas, they had all the answers. That's just like a lawyer, isn't it? I mean, that's basically what they were. They were, and they had even more answers, I think, when King Herod called them together and he said, you guys better come up with some good answers. You know, last week we said, you know, Herod was one, he was kind of a bloodthirsty king. If he didn't get what he wanted, you didn't live very long. I mean, he had his wife executed, he had his mother-in-law executed, two of his sons, and about 300 court guards. I mean, if you got in Herod's way, you ceased to breathe. And so, could you imagine, and now the chief priests and scribes were 72. Could you imagine a room full of 72 lawyers? And the king standing there asking questions? It was either mass confusion or they all were smart enough that they got on the page, same page at the same time really quick. And I think that's what they did, because they all, I think as they went around the room, they're like, yep, Bethlehem of Judea, that's where it is. That's where Jesus is to be born. And that's what Micah said. You know, he said, that's what the priest said, the prophet said. So, yep, I think about 72 times that the king got, yep, that's what Micah says in Micah chapter 5, verse 2. And here's what it says. And you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means at least, by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For from you will come a ruler who will shepherd my people, Israel. The chief priests and scribes were the ones the king sought out to tell him where Jesus was. I guess no one questioned when or if. The king did not, he was not like, can you tell us if Jesus is going to be born? Can you tell us when he's going to be born? It was not about that. For Herod, it was like, where is he? I just want to know, where is he? And, you know, I couldn't help but think, you know, that's the question that we need to be asking, too. Where is he? Where is Jesus? Where, that would be a good question. I think if we can answer that question, that really Christmas time is not going to sneak up on us. It's not going to be about those gifts under the tree. It's not going to be about totally about the shopping trips. It's not going to be about the exact decoration being in the right place at the right time. It's not going to be about a lot of things that we stress out over. If I can answer the question, where is Jesus? Christmas would be a whole lot more fun and a whole lot more exciting. And I believe we wouldn't have to worry about, are we in the Christmas spirit? Because the Spirit's in us. The answer to that question with today, hopefully that answer to that question would be, he's right here. He's in my heart. I know exactly where he is. He's not lost. I don't have to look for him. I don't have to wonder where he is during this Christmas time. It's Christmas time and Jesus is in my heart. So, Herod just wanted to know where he was. Where is Jesus? Are you a follower of the star? Like those wise men? That star alerted them. So I want to ask you, I want us to satisfy ourselves in our mind and in our hearts. Are we following the bright and morning star? That star that lets us know without a doubt, no matter what's going on in the world, and we can talk about that a little bit more in detail here in just a minute. But the chief priest could answer the question, all the Christmas questions. They knew the facts, they knew the references, they knew the book, they knew the chapter, they knew the verse, but that's about where it ended for the chief scribes or chief priests and scribes. Now, isn't that kind of sad? I mean, they had all the facts, they had all the details. Their mind knew all that stuff. And really, there's a lot of people in the world today that can give you all the facts. They have the understanding. They know the story. They know the whole story about Jesus and him coming as a baby. But that's about where it ends. They don't know him in a personal way. They're not like the shepherds or not like the wise men. They're not seeking him. They're not looking for the place where they can go worship. They're not looking at all. They just have that information in their heart or in their mind, and it's totally superficial. They're just factoid machines for the most part. Maybe some of them knew Jesus or wanted to know Jesus in a personal way, but it was a pretty dark and dangerous day for everyone. I think especially for those 72 men. Life was a little scary and confusing, to say the least, because Herod was a demanding, blood-shedding tyrant, and the Jews were afraid. Now, I don't want to spend a whole lot of time on this because Christmas is supposed to be a happy time, right? But any of you have fear in your heart these days? Are you fearful about things, about maybe things you don't know or don't understand? About the future, maybe we can't see how things are going to work out in our favor or in our benefit. Maybe we can't even entertain how it's going to work out at all. Seems like a big bunch of confusion. Well, that's kind of how it was in that day too, especially for the Jewish people, because they had no idea what was in their future. They may not live five more minutes under the rule of this tyrant. The Jews needed a Savior. The Jewish people needed a shepherd. They needed a deliverer. They needed a king. They needed Christmas. They needed peace and protection, goodwill on earth. Now, I don't want to say this. Christmas changed everything. Last week, several times I said it's all about Jesus. Whether it's Christmas or not, it's all about Jesus. But Christmas changed everything. Those people were helpless and hopeless, fearful. There was not a lot of good things going on for them. And Christmas changed all that. I think that's one of the things that is so exciting about Christmas. Each year you kind of get a renewed sense of peace and a renewed sense of who's really in charge. You know, Jesus was born a baby and he was the king. He was in charge. He was the king from the day he was born. And from the very day he was born and through all of eternity, he is still going to be the king. Even those people knew that. Herod knew it. The wise men knew it. People in that day knew that Jesus being born, that first Christmas, changed everything. It changed the world. The world has never been the same again, and it never will be the same again. And not only did the birth of Jesus bring change and cause for celebration, the birth of Jesus brought hope and justice and peace and salvation and forgiveness and comfort and joy and happiness. Just what the world needed, right? Just what the world needed. Then and now. Not superficial understanding and knowledge, but real change for all mankind. Now, like I said, the time before Jesus' birth was one of hate and confusion and controversy. Is that starting to sound a little bit familiar to you, maybe? Is there any parallel between maybe the days there when Jesus was born and the days that we live in today?
Yes.
I mean, there's a pretty straight line parallel. It's kind of like when I read this, I'm like, man, this could have been written today or last week or a few months ago. Those people needed Jesus. And so I want to tell you, I don't know what it looks like under your Christmas tree. Maybe there's all kinds of gifts under there. Maybe there's a lot of things in your mind. Maybe you've already put out your Christmas list. Maybe it's on Amazon. You know, most people, except for me, I don't know how to do that. A lot of people have an Amazon list or a Christmas wish list. And maybe you do. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with that. I'm just saying I don't know how to do it. But I can tell you what the greatest gift that you could wish for this year would be the very fact that you would feel Jesus and his presence in your heart. Even if you didn't have anything under the Christmas tree for yourself or for anyone else, it would still be Christmas time in the city. As long as we just have Jesus, as long as it's not a superficial understanding and a knowledge, a real change for mankind. So they needed Christmas. The world needs Jesus. Then and always, and always will. Now for a while I've been looking at world events and saying, you know, this can't last much longer. But you know, I don't know how much longer it's going to last. My dad was telling me 50 years ago it was not going to last much longer. Like, it's the end of time. It's all over with. And now, 50 years later, I'm standing here thinking, hey, it's all over with. I don't know when it's going to be all over with, and neither does anybody else except for God. But I do know one thing. No matter what's going on, no matter if we have King Herod the Great, or who is in the White House or on the king's throne somewhere else, as long as Jesus is in our heart, it's still going to be a good, happy Christmas.
Amen.
So we're desperately in need, and we need to seek and to find Jesus during this Christmas time. Chaos, hate, and confusion. In my lifetime, it's an all-time high. I don't remember a time when there's been. I do remember when I was a kid, sitting on the living room floor watching TV. My dad watched the news every night. He read the newspaper and watched the news on TV. That's about all I remember him doing after he came in the house at night. except for when he went to bed, he read his Bible. He'd go get in the bed and read his Bible. But I remember laying on the living room floor looking at all kinds of protest and just chaos and unrest back when I was a kid, back in the 60s. So it's not a new thing, is it? The world's always been crazy, hasn't it? There's always been chaos. There's always been problems. There's always been pain. There's always been hate. And the only hope that we've ever had, then or now, is Jesus. Amen. He's the only hope that we have. So I want to recommend, if you don't already have that, understand it and know all about, I want to recommend Jesus to you as a gift. He gave himself to us as a gift. And he wants us to have that gift, if nothing else, at this Christmas time. Like the Christmas day when these words are written. I'm going to read a poem for you. And I want you, see if you recognize these words. See if you recognize who wrote this, what it is. I heard the bells on Christmas Day, their old familiar carols play. A wild and sweet, and wild and sweet the words repeat, of peace on earth, goodwill to men. And thought how, as the day had come, the belfries of all Christendom had rolled along the unbroken song of peace on earth, goodwill to men. Till ringing, singing on its way, the world revolved from night to day. A voice, a chime, a chant sublime of peace on earth, goodwill to men. Then from each black accursed mouth, the cannon thundered in the south. And with the sound, the carols drowned of peace on earth, goodwill to men. It was as if an earthquake rent the earth, the hearthstones of a continent, and made forlorn the households born of peace on earth, goodwill to men. And I bowed my head in despair and thought, there is no peace on earth, I said, for hate is strong and mocks the song of peace on earth, goodwill to men. Then pealed the bells more loud and deep. God is not dead, nor doth he sleep. The wrong shall fail, the right prevail, with peace on earth, goodwill to men. Amen. Does anybody know who that was? That was written in 1863. By Henry Wadsworth Longfellow. There's a little story behind the reason why Henry wrote that poem. About 2 years before this, his wife died in a tragic fire. Actually, her clothes caught on fire. And she was burned to the point that she died the next day. And Henry couldn't even attend her funeral because he had tried to put the fire out and he was burned so bad that he couldn't even function himself. So, kind of a sad, sad day. 2 years before he wrote this. And Longfellow wrote this on Christmas Day as the Civil War raged, 1863. Can you imagine maybe a worse time in our country? His wife had died shortly before as a result of the fire, leaving him widowed and father of six. His oldest son was in the hospital with an injury from fighting in the Civil War. It was surely a dark and scary day. And for most Americans at that time as well. So there's a hymn. The hymn that uses Longfellow's lyrics was composed in 1872 by John Calkin. Now, I'm going to use this hymn as my closing song. I want you to listen closely to the sadness and despair and hopelessness as it fades away with peace and hope and joy. That doesn't happen by superficial knowledge of Christmas. Doesn't happen by superficial knowledge of Jesus. We need an intimate. We need to intimately know the God that Longfellow wrote about. Once again, then pealed the bells more loud and deep. God is not dead, nor doth he sleep. The wrong shall fail, the right prevail. With peace on earth, goodwill to men. We're going to have a song here in just a second. And I want to invite you, maybe you're sitting here today and maybe in your heart there is chaos and there's fear and there's not much peace and there's not much happiness, not much contentment. Maybe there's just a lot of wrong things, bad things that are bouncing around in your heart and in your head. Maybe it's hard making sense of any of it. Well, I would invite you this morning, and by the way, this altar is always open. Anytime you feel the tug of God that says, come and pray at the altar. But I want to invite you, as we have our closing song, if you feel the need to come and pray, maybe there's specific needs. Maybe it's not about Christmas at all. Maybe it's the fact that maybe there's just chaos in your heart. Maybe you need to know that Jesus, the one that the wise man so desperately sought, the one that Herod so desperately tried to kill, the one that the chief priests and scribes knew all about, the same one is the one that can bring that peace. Peace on earth, goodwill to men. Let's stand together.
Oh,
God is not dead, nor doth he sleep.
Amen.
The wrong shall fail, the right prevail.